No need to wonder. God is real. Let's keep it real with points to ponder.
Hello, family. I'm Tyrone Holcomb, and I'm the host who loves to bring you close. And of course, I'm talking about bringing you closer to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the way that I'm able to do that is through this podcast called Points to Ponder. And you know I like to remind you that it is your points to ponder. And I am excited and delighted that once again, you have decided to join me here this week. I want to begin a series that I'm calling Church Constructs. Church Constructs. It's amazing how we as the body of Christ, we're the church of the living God. And yet and still, we may not even really understand what all of that means. What does it mean to be the church of God? Too often we're having church and we're not conducting ourselves the way that we ought to. Now, let me hasten to say that I'm not here to get on church folk because I'm church folk. I'm a part of the body of Christ, but I believe the Spirit of the living God has placed it upon my heart to, for the next several weeks, deal with this series entitled Church Constructs. So this way, we can move from simply believing in Jesus Christ to behaving the way that Jesus Christ would have us to behave. And that is simply to say, like the church. What is the church? Well, the church, we are many things, but we are the bride of Christ. Now, I didn't say we're the bride of God, God the Father. See, God's bride is Israel. God married Israel. And God has given the church, that is you and I, to become the bride of Christ. So what does that make God to us? Well, God becomes our father-in-law. You see how that goes? See, he is God the Father who brought the law through Moses. And ever since he's given us the law, we have this law that is to remind us that we are sinners, that all of us have the capacity, the ability to sin. And therefore, we need a Savior. And the Savior is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is not only our Savior, but Jesus Christ is our husbandman. We're married to Jesus Christ. And not only is he our husbandman, but Jesus Christ is the foundation of the church. Let me go ahead and go into Revelation chapter 1, because this is where our series will come from. Revelation chapter 1. I want to read verses 10 through 12, and then 16 and verse 20 in the King James Version of the scripture. And this is what it reads. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and heard behind me a great voice, as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And he had in his right hand seven stars. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his countenance was as the sun shineth in the strength. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Wow, I know I said a mouthful, but if you would, let me try to unpack some of this revelation. Here, John the Revelator, he's writing the revelations that he received on the island of Patmos. And John said that he heard a voice talking to him. And when he turned, this was Jesus who was speaking to John. And John told us that not only was the voice coming from Jesus, but Jesus had seven candlesticks and seven stars in his hand. The seven stars, my brothers and sisters, those represented the pastors of the churches. The pastors are also called angels of the house. And we'll see this later on as we begin to unearth this particular series. But the pastors are also called the angels of the house. Now, they're not angelic beings like we know angels to be. However, they were called the angels or messengers, because that's what angels are. Angels are messengers of God. And so pastors, if you would, they are a form of angels, is how God calls them and considers them, because they're his messengers. And Jesus is saying to John that I have pastors in my hand, as well as seven candlesticks, and the candlesticks represent the churches themselves. Now, let me hasten to say, when we talk about pastors, we are to honor our pastors, because God has given us pastors according to his own heart. That's what the book of Jeremiah tells us. But we are not to look at pastors and hold them up with such a regard that we reverence them like they are God, because pastors, they are God's instruments, and we're to never hold them up on a pedestal like they're monuments. So we need to understand that God says, I have seven stars, and that's because they are to bring light unto the church, and that light is illumination for revelation, so that God's people can understand more about who God is in their lives, or I should say in our lives, and then know how we are to conduct ourselves in this dark and dismal world. Having said that, that's why he called the churches the candlesticks, because we are to be the light in this dark world. When we come around, people that are discouraged should become encouraged. People who are ignorant should be filled with information as well as revelation of God's love, because God is love. God is life. And make no mistake, God is light in this dark world. And so we're going to begin to talk about the blueprint and the pattern in this particular series, Church Constructs. We'll talk about that in this series, because Jesus, I believe, what he was given unto John was a blueprint, so that not only the seven churches that were named inside this particular text would know how to conduct themselves, but so that the churches thereafter, even today, we as the body of Christ, as the church of the living God, we would know how to behave ourselves. So when we talk about church constructs, what is constructs? Well, the word construct, it means to build, or it means to form, to put together parts and pieces. That's what it means to construct. It also means, as a noun, a mental image, idea, or a theory. It's especially of a complex form of different elements, simpler elements that are put together. And so we collectively, we bring on the constructs of the church. But then constructs also deals with our values, rules, morals, willpower, and self-control. All of these elements that we learn in church, it brings about what we call the constructs. It's the church constructs. And what we're going to learn as we move forward, I won't have time to teach on it tonight, but we're going to talk about the seven churches and the message that Jesus gave to each of those churches. He brought, if you would, accommodations, and then he also brought accusations. So in other words, he told them what they were doing right, but then he also warned them about the things they were doing wrong. And if we would be honest to say this much, not many of us have went into the book of Revelations and discovered the messages that Jesus was speaking to the church. How can we call ourselves the church of the living God, and we don't really know the message that Jesus spoke to each one of these churches? And if we don't get the message that he spoke to the seven churches, then how can we honestly say that we're operating accordingly? How do we know that we're operating according to God's will, His word in His way? It's important for us to delve into this series so that we know what the church is supposed to look like. And therefore, when we walk away, we know how we are supposed to be put on display. We know how not only we should act in church, but more importantly, how we should act in the world, on our jobs, at home with our families. Because it's a whole lot that goes into how we ought to behave ourselves in the church. See, it's one thing to believe in God. That's how we get saved. When we believe in Jesus Christ, when we accept the work that He did on the cross. Remember, I said that we are the bride of Christ. The church is the bride of Christ. And this was made possible because Jesus, He didn't come and offer unto us a ring that we may marry Him. No, He offered unto us Himself upon the cross. The same way the ring is presented to the bride in our culture, Jesus came and presented the cross to us. In other words, He was the substitution. See, two things happened on the cross. First and foremost, the substitution. By substitution, what I'm saying is that Jesus, He became the substitution so that we don't have to die for the sins that we committed. See, in the Old Testament, the sheep, they died for the shepherd. So whenever the shepherd once a year had to go to the priest, he would bring to the priest a sheep or a lamb, and the sheep had to die instead of the shepherd dying for his sins. That was in the Old Testament. But when Jesus Christ ushered in the New Testament, then Jesus being the good shepherd, He died for all the sheep, and that's you and I. Did you get that? See, the shepherd, the good shepherd, the chief shepherd, Jesus Christ, He died for the sheep. And so that was substitution. That's the first thing that happened when Jesus died on the cross. But then that was Jesus' part. Our part in the covenant is identification. See, He was our substitution, but then we have to identify with Jesus Christ. And when I say the church has to identify, it's as if a woman, when she marries a man and she becomes his wife, she takes on his name. She takes the same name that he has. And that's why we're called even Christians, because we are Christ-like. We take on Jesus Christ's name. And therefore, when we are in this covenant now, we identify with Jesus Christ. So much so that when Jesus spoke to Paul in the book of Acts, he said, "Paul, why are you persecuting me?" And who Paul was persecuting in that day, he was persecuting the church. Paul was out there, you know, if you would, persecuting all the people who said they believe in Jesus Christ. But when Jesus knocked Paul off his high horse while Paul was on his way to Damascus, Jesus said, "Saul, Saul," because that was Paul's name at the time. He said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" See, in essence, Jesus was saying, because you're persecuting the church, you're persecuting me, because the church so identifies with Jesus Christ. And so we have to understand that those two things is what took place when Jesus died on the cross. He was our substitution, but then we identified with his death. And therefore, we're now married to Him. We need the church. If we did not need the church, if the church was not necessary, number one, Jesus, He would not have sent to John these messages to give to these seven churches and subsequently all the churches that came after those churches in Asia. If the church was not necessary, Jesus would not have found it necessary to send this message. And then, secondarily, Jesus would not have said He's building His church. See, in the book of, I believe it's Matthew's, yes, it's Matthew's chapter 17, Jesus asked His disciples, "Whom do men say that I am?" And his disciples began to reiterate the rumor on the streets. They said, some say you are Elijah, some say you're Jeremiah, some say you're just a prophet. And Jesus says, okay, well, I've heard what some are saying, but now who do you say that I am? And the disciples was puzzled. But out of the 12 disciples, one disciple, Peter, he spoke up. He said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus then spoke to Peter specifically. He says, Peter, you are blessed because man has not revealed this to you, but my Father, which is in heaven. And he said to Peter, he says, you are Petra. That's the Greek word for a piece of the rock. He says, you are Petra. He says, and upon this rock, right? That's Petra. And he told Peter, excuse me, you are Petro. That's the Greek word for little rock. He says, you are Petro. But then he went on to say, but upon this Petra, that's the foundation. He says, I'm building my church. Now, he wasn't saying that he's building his church on Peter, but rather he was building his church on the revelation that Peter had. And the revelation was, Jesus, you are the Christ. You are the Messiah. Jesus, you are our Savior. And Jesus says, now upon that revelation, I'm going to build my church, in the gates of hell, they will not prevail against us. Now, it's important for us as the church. Listen to me, family. We have to have a series that I'm about to teach on so that we know how the church is supposed to be constructed and how we are to conduct ourselves. Because if we don't have the blueprint, if we do not follow the pattern, we can get off course and we can enter into an idea that was no idea of God's. And so it's so important that we understand this. See, if we don't have these messages that Jesus gave to John to unveil to the churches, then we can think that we're doing something right or that we have something and we don't really have what we think we have. See, we can think that we are a rich church, and in essence, we could be a poor church. Where do I see this at? If we look over in Revelation chapter 3, verse 17, this is what it reads in the King James Version. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, miserable, and poor, blind, and naked. So here was a church that said, we are rich, because they felt they didn't need anything. And Jesus says, no, you are wretched, you are miserable. He says, and you're even poor, blind, as well as naked. So in one sense, you got a church that believes they're rich, and Jesus says, no, you're really poor. But then in another sense, you could have a church who may be perceived as poor, and yet they are really rich. We find this over in Revelation chapter 2, verse 9. Again, the King James Version. Jesus says, I know thy works and tribulations and poverty. See, people thought they were poor. In poverty, he says, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Wow. See, some people, they think they are one way in church, but God sees them another way. Even to the degree Jesus says, you could be of the synagogue of Satan. Whew. Man, I'm telling you, this is serious. It really is serious that we have to come to an understanding of what is the church supposed to look like. We're talking about the church's character. Whenever I talk about church constructs, in essence, I'm talking about the church's character. What is the attitude that we ought to have as the church of the living God? How about our morals, our values? How are we to have self-control and then willpower and remain in the will of God? All of this deals with the church's constructs, the church's character. And the only person who can judge us is not we ourselves, but it's the Lord. We find over in Revelation chapter 2, verse 23, the Message Bible, then every church will know that appearances don't impress me. I x-ray every motive and make sure you get what's coming to you. Wow. Jesus said that he's going to x-ray every church. You know what an x-ray is? An x-ray is an apparatus that gives us the ability to see what we naturally couldn't see or that we're unable to see with our naked eye. So I can't look at my chest and see my heart or my lungs. No, not without an x-ray. And only God is able to look at the church with an x-ray and see really, truly the heart of the church and the motives of the church. And so we must examine ourselves. Remember, the church persecuted gives opportunities for the church's purification. Let me say that again. The church's persecution, it gives opportunities for the church to be purified. That's simply to say, oftentimes, God, he'll take the church and he'll bring suffering upon the people in the house of God, only so that he can purify us, only so that he can clean us up. It's so imperative that we operate the way God would have us to operate. And so I want to delve into this series in the weeks ahead. I'm going to talk about what Jesus said to these seven churches. And therefore, we can look at the accommodations that he gave them, the recommendations that he offered, but then the accusations that he brought against the church so that we would be forewarned and not move into areas that we ought not move into. I can recall that Peter, on another account, he was on the Mount of Transfiguration with James and John, and they were up there with Jesus. And Jesus was talking to Moses and Elisha. And while they were talking, Peter, he got beside himself and he said, Lord, it's good that we be up here seeing you talk with Moses and Elijah. Now at this time, Moses and Elijah, they had been dead. And so Peter, rightfully so, was amazed to see Moses and Elijah alive, talking to Jesus. And he said, it's good that we be here. He said, let us make three tabernacles. Let us build churches, if you would. One for Moses and one for Elijah, and then one for you, Lord. And while Peter was talking, God spoke and God said, this is my beloved son, talking about Jesus, in whom I'm well pleased. He said, hear ye him. In essence, focus on him. And the Bible says that Peter, James, and John, they put their heads down to the ground in fear. And when they looked back up, they saw no other man except Jesus Christ only. And that's a warning for us, because too often we get caught up in personalities in the church and not focusing on the person of Jesus Christ. And so it's so important, my brothers and my sisters, that we understand the church constructs, that we follow the character that God has designed for the church. And that's what I want to talk about. You know, before I go, I want to share this little joke that I heard. My wife shared it with me. And that is, there was a first-time visitor who went to a particular church. And when he went to the church, he had on a white t-shirt and just some jeans. And when he went to the church, the pastor was preaching and he happened to see this visitor with his white t-shirt on and some blue jeans. And after his sermon, the pastor made his way over to the first-time visitor. And the pastor said in a soft reprimand, he said, sir, I thank you for coming to our church, but you should know not to come to church dressed in that manner, not this kind of church. He says, so what I want you to do is I want you to go home and pray to God and ask God how you should dress when you come to this church. Well, lo and behold, that following Sunday, that man showed up again and he had on white t-shirt, and this time he had some holes in his jeans. And the pastor saw him in the audience and couldn't wait to finish his sermon. And when the sermon was through, the pastor made his way to to that man again, and he said, sir, he said, I thought I asked you last week to go and pray to God and to ask God how you should dress in this kind of church. And the man said to the pastor, oh, I did go pray to God and asked him. And the pastor said, you did? He said, well, then what did God say to you? And the man said, God told me he don't know how to dress in this church because he's never been here. Wow. See, we could be the kind of church that we think we're serving God, that we think that we're displaying the love of God, and all along we're missing God. And I want to share with us in the next several weeks this series entitled Church Constructs, so that we can have the character of Christ. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, it tells us, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, in so much the more as you see the day approaching. My brothers and my sisters, see, God says, do not forsake the assembling. That word assembling, it means putting the pieces together, the construct. It means to build. And God is wanting us to build his church, but build the church that the Lord Jesus Christ started building when he spoke to Peter. Build the church up on Jesus Christ. He's the foundation. And therefore, our foundation, it should be love, light, in life. We can just start right there. If you're in church and there's no life in the church, if you're in church and there's no light, meaning no word bringing illumination and revelation to the body of Christ, if you're in church and there's no love, there's no embracing of the brothers and sisters, there's no encouragement coming from the brothers and sisters, well, you can bet your bottom dollar that you might not be in the right church. And most importantly, you might not be the church of the living God. My brothers and my sisters, I pray that this word has blessed you. I want you to really get ready for what we're going to hear in the weeks ahead as it pertains to this series, Church Construct. I solely believe, I surely believe that the Spirit of the living God is going to bless us in such a way that not only will we believe in God, we'll begin to behave the way God would have us to behave, and ultimately we'll become what God created the church to become. And what's that? The light of the world. This world that's dark, dismal, and discouraging, it needs us to be its light. We're to be the salt of the earth. That is to say, we're to preserve. That's what salt does. It preserves the dying process. And so if you are in the church, and more importantly, if you are a part of the church of the living God, the body of Christ, then you have to move from church work to doing the work of the church. I'm going to say that again. You got to move from church work to doing the work of the church. And what is the work of the church? It's to share with this world Jesus Christ, so that somebody on your job, in your family, in your neighborhood, somebody you know, they don't have to go to hell. They don't have to spend eternity in damnation, but they can be saved. They can be brought into God's light, life, and his very love. My friends, I pray this word has been a blessing to you. I'm asking that you share this word with your family as well as with your friends. And then I'm asking that you subscribe to this channel. If you're watching this program and you have not subscribed, I'm asking that you subscribe to us on YouTube under Tyrone Holcomb and help me get this word out so that so many people, they can be blessed just as you were. Until next week, I'm asking you to stay safe. And above all things, as you're facing challenges in this world, remember this: God is real. God bless. We love you.